In this episode, I'm going to explain how to investigate UV cure using differential scanning calorimetry. You're already familiar with the principle of DSC from some of the previous videos, and it's really about measuring heat flux effects between a sample and the furnace and a reference and the furnace to see the differences we get in the two signals. And in most DSCs, that is done as a function of temperature, but you can also use a photo DSC to study that effect as a function of UV. So how does a curing reaction in a DSC look like? And for a typical thermal cure material, like an epoxy, the curve looks like this. We have here our DSC signal as a function, or our heat flow as a function of temperature. And the first thing we see is that we have a glass transition temperature, the step and change in specific heat capacity. And then we have the curing that's happening, and we have the release of heat. It's an exothermal process. So exothermal goes down, an exothermal process. And that leads to the cure of this material. And then when we cool it down and have a second heating, then we actually only see a glass transition temperature. And that glass transition temperature is at significantly higher temperatures as the glass transition of the liquid components. That also an indication that it cured, and that new network that is irreversibly built has a higher glass transition temperature, which means that cured material has a higher thermal stability. And that's really what we're looking for. We want to understand how the curing happens as a function of temperature and time, and how, for example, the glass transition temperature changes before and after cure. And since we're talking about UV curable materials, we use a DSC that is also able to give us the UV curing information. So in addition to a UV to a furnace that can change the temperature, we also have a UV lamp, as indicated here, that instead of just the furnace, the sample can be exposed to UV light. And as you can see, we also do that on both the sample and the reference, and get the difference in reaction and compare that. And so how does something like that look? In this case, I'm showing you the measurement of a dual cure resin that we measured in this photo DSC, the Phoenix, that would be representative for VAT photopolarization, or better, digital light synthesis, because it's that dual cure resin for that process. And what we did here, I'm just showing that briefly, we had a UV curing segment and a thermal curing segment afterwards. So for 5 minutes, we exposed the material to UV light, waited, and then after 5 minutes, we increased we used 6.8 second UV exposure at 0.5 watt per square centimeters. We waited for the full 5 minutes, and then we increased the temperature from 30 to 120 degrees C at 3 Kelvin per minute. And that's what you see here. So UV cure followed by the thermal cure for a polyurethane resin. And it's that top-down process that we have talked about. And now, what do we see? Exothermal reaction is facing downward. So we see, as the material is exposed to UV light, we see a first exothermal reaction that gives us an area under the peak. And then we have the thermal cure following, and we also see that there's a deviation from the baseline, but we really have to look at that in more detail. So we increase that area with that detail image, and you can really see there's a deviation, and the area under that curve is 20.89 joule per gram. So that's the exothermal enthalpy during thermal cure. We want to compare that to the UV cure, but there's another important thing. During the UV cure, we also have a temperature increase because of the light exposure and not only the reaction. So we have to get that effect subtracted. And the way we do that is we do this correction measurement. So we have our first UV cure, then the thermal cure. We cool the material down. We have a fully cured sample, and now we expose that again for the same duration with the same density. And because no curing reaction can now happen, we actually can only see what thermal effect we get from the light. So I also have that in more detail here. The blue is the initial cure, then the black is the reaction we get on the fully cured sample, and then we use the functionality of the Proteus software to subtract one from the other, and then the green curve is actually our corrected area that is representative of just the pure UV cure reaction. And so you see that is slightly different at 70.29 joule per gram. But now we know for this exposure of 6.8 seconds how the UV cure enthalpy and the thermal cure correlate. And when we look at that, we see for the 6.8 seconds, really the majority of the cure, 70 joule per gram, happens due to the UV cure rather than the thermal cure that was only roughly 20 joule per gram. And in the study published by Obst and others, they did these experiments, but they also studied the effect of different exposure times. They repeated those experiments, and then they also printed samples and studied the mechanical properties. And here you can see a schematic of their results. We see the exposure time is increasing along the x-axis, and the tensile strength and elongation at break are on the y-axis. And what they found was that the UV curing time was responsible for the strength of the parts and their ductility, which means at 6.8 seconds, the tensile strength is really high. If we have a shorter exposure time and more happens during the thermal cure, the material is not as strong. And at the same time, the ductility is reduced, which we see as the elongation at break. So this is really a cool way. We have a complex chemical reaction, a complex resin system, because it's UV curable and thermally curable, or it actually needs both to fulfill its full property potential. And a photo DSC like the Phoenix 208F1 is suitable to study this combination of UV cure and thermal cure. So that's a pretty neat a tool to use to evaluate your materials, to develop your processes, and be just a lot faster than trial and error by just mixing some materials together and then trying them in the 3D printer.